Good morning and happy Easter, First Love family. We are going to be having some worship in just a little bit, as well as having some special guest worship, followed by our very own Pastor John giving his Easter service message. So stick around for all that coming up and more. I hope everyone is having a great Easter so far and staying safe. God bless you all, and we'll see you shortly.
Father, we thank you, Lord, for this morning, this Easter morning that we're celebrating. We thank you for coming for us, Lord, and for dying and for rising, Lord. We thank you for your power, Lord, over the grave. We thank you for your power in our lives, Lord. Thank you for your love and faithfulness, Lord. We want to just give you thanks and praise this morning, Lord. Thank you for being a God who is in control and sovereign and full of power, Lord, and we thank you for your love and your wisdom and mercy. We pray, Lord, that this morning as we worship you, just rejoicing in all that you've done for us in the resurrection, that you would be honored and magnified, you'd be lifted up and fully praised from our hearts and our minds and our lips. And we thank you, Lord, and praise you and ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hello and welcome to First Love Calvary Chapel, to our Easter service. And I'd just like to say to you, Happy Resurrection Day, because this is everything about Jesus rising again from the dead. And the message today is the shocking resurrection revealed. A shock is something that we didn't expect to happen, but it kind of surprisingly came upon us. And sometimes events in life are like that. And this, of course, being the greatest event that people just were not aware, even though Jesus had told them ahead of time that the Son of Man will be crucified, he'll resurrect. But here you look at such a gruesome and brutal event as a crucifixion, and the kind that the Romans dealt with for criminals. And to think that from that, God would use the evil of man to bring about such a glorious resurrection. And so God definitely uses the bad things that we go through, the troubles in our lives, to create something good out of it. In this case, the salvation of the world. Jesus died for our sins, and he rose for our justification. His death brought life to us. And so God had the most surprising plan for all of mankind, for them to find out, even to this day in 2020. And God likes the feeling of surprise, but yet at the same time, the feeling of surprise in the midst of the fact that he told us. You know, when it comes to the end times, it says it's going to take the world by surprise, but for the believer, we love his appearing. And so when it comes to this particular event, the death and resurrection of Christ, the disciples were kind of unaware, even though on several occasions Jesus had told them that this is what's going to be happening. And so when it comes to news, a lot of times people don't like bad news. They don't like to just be surprised with some sort of news. You know, I remember one time my wife, her father had died, and I had to think, how am I going to share this with my wife? And I kind of came up with a plan of how I would share it, because we know that when it's something that causes hurt, you know, we're trying to figure out how can a person handle that. And so when it came to the death of Jesus, I mean, you know, people were taking him to the tomb, preparing certain spices to, you know, take care of the body. And in no way were they expecting that they're going to come to an empty tomb, that there's going to be a total resurrection. I will say that there was a lack of certainty in the disciples' hearts. In fact, they were hiding out in their house with a locked door. And even the women were coming there early in the morning expecting to find a tomb and wondering who was going to roll away the stone for them. And then when Jesus revealed himself to Mary, she just assumed that it was the gardener in the midst of the dusk of the morning and whatever clothes he had put on there. And so they, you know, she's like, you must be the gardener in her mind. But then when he talked to her and she heard his voice, she said, oh, Rabbi, teacher. And so basically, I will say that there is definitely in our minds with resurrection, there is sometimes uncertainty. There's something that our minds create its own story after death. Sometimes people, you know, because their mother died, and they'll say, well, my mom came and she sat at the foot of my bed and she talked to me and it was so real and it must have happened. And because God created the mind to be such a powerful thing and denial of death to be so strong, that the mind just kind of fills in the blanks and it becomes real. It feels real because of how strong the mind is and how powerful the effects of death are on the human mind. Because originally, he meant for man to live joyfully in the garden. And yet man brought forth death and then God brought forth life. And so I will say regarding the resurrection, this particular thing, it was a certainty of God that his words would come true. It says in one verse in Proverbs 22:21, that I may make you know the certainty of the words of truth. God wants us to know that what he said is going to happen, will happen, and does happen. And right now we have a lot of uncertainty in these uncertain times. And you wonder about your family, your future, your work, and all of these things. But you know, the Lord does know ahead of time what's going to happen. He has a plan, and the plan is definitely a good one. In Luke chapter 1, verse 4, it says that you may know the certainty of those things in which you were instructed. And so, are you so certain about what you've always believed, what you've known to be true, as far as the death and the resurrection of Christ, as far as Jesus in your heart, as far as forgiveness of sins, and as far as that God has your life in his hands and he's going to take care of you? And so if somebody comes and brings some shocking news to you, is it going to destroy you? Are you going to absolutely fall apart from this time on? You know, the disciples, when they had heard that Jesus was resurrected from the dead as Mary came, it says they thought it was just some tale that she was telling them, some fairy tale. And yet they themselves had heard Christ say it. But there's just something about how can a person come back after they've already died? And so, but Jesus was with them and they didn't get it. And so then when Jesus wasn't with them, they still didn't get it. And so I think that's one reason why we kind of need to be patient with one another. When you see people that you fellowship with or in your family, and they're at some sort of a lower level of understanding or growth, and you get frustrated, like, why don't they know what I'm talking about? But you know, the disciples just didn't know and they didn't get it. But the appearing of the Son of Man shook the world when he first came as a baby, even though it was quiet, and they didn't know that that had happened. And the exit of Jesus shook that particular world at that time, as that sign is nailed to the cross, that he's the King of the Jews, and it's written in every language. And so there are things that God likes to use that are shocking. But he wants us to know that these events, these surprises, these big things are meant to be part of God's plan, are meant to help us. Yeah, they're unbelievable moments. Yeah, they create somewhat feelings of uncertainty in us. Jesus in John chapter 14, verses 9 and 10, he said this to one of his disciples. Jesus said to him, "Have I been with you so long and yet you have not known me, Philip? He who has seen me has seen the Father. So how can you say, 'Show us the Father'? So have I not been with you so long and you basically haven't known me?" See, sometimes we are around Jesus, around church, around the Word, around other Christians, and yet we just don't know. And God wants us to get to know something a whole lot better. When Peter at one time was in prison, and the church was gathered together in the book of Acts chapter 12, and they were praying for him. They were actually praying for his release. And, you know, when he actually was released and an angel set him free, and he comes to the gate, and this gal named Rhoda, sister in the Lord, answers the door, she runs away from him, so excited that he's freed, and to tell everybody, not just opening the gate. And then it says in Acts chapter 12, verse 13, because they're surprised and it's unexpected and they don't think it's real, it says in verse 13, "And as Peter knocked at the door of the gate, a girl named Rhoda came to answer. And when she recognized Peter's voice because of her gladness, she did not open the gate, but ran in and announced that Peter stood before the gate. But they said to her, 'You are beside yourself.' Yet she kept insisting that it was so. So they said, 'It's his angel.' And now Peter continued knocking. And then they opened the door and saw him, and they were astonished." And that's a key word there, astonished, amazement, that people don't always grasp. They don't always latch on to the true story, something that seems beyond reality, beyond possibility. But we serve a God that can do the absolute impossible, that he can go beyond the expectations of man, or even the education of man, even the understanding of man of what's possible and not possible. And so our minds are slow to catch up, and they're also slow to believe. When Jesus was walking on water, which obviously is an impossibility, his disciples were saying, it's a ghost. It's obviously not Jesus walking on water. And in Luke chapter 24, verse 25. Luke chapter 24, verse 25 says, "Then he said to them, 'O foolish ones, and slow of heart to believe.'" Now check that phrase out in Luke 24, 25. It says, "Slow of heart to believe. And all that the prophets have spoken," like everything that you've already read about and heard about in the Word of God, you're just slow in heart to believe it. "Ought not the Christ to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory?" And so Jesus was sharing that after his resurrection to a couple of disciples that needed to be talked into what had happened. And then he revealed himself to them. There are all kinds of emotional responses that we have in the surprises and the shocks of life. But the idea of Jesus not remaining in the grave, when finally Peter and John wanted to go check it out for themselves, it says that they ran to the tomb, and one brother outran the other brother. And they looked in, and one of them actually went in. They wanted that hands-on, first-hand experience so that way they could believe. And so how do you react when you're majorly surprised? Do things just make your head spin? Do you not believe for joy as some of them didn't believe for joy? And you know, there's a lot of things that put us into a tailspin. In our home, my wife and her cancer, it kind of put us into a tailspin. And there are times where even the simplest things I become shocked over. My wife realized when we were first dating, and I'm driving up to the mountains, and I'm halfway, and I realized I didn't have enough gas, and I go, oh my gosh, and like there's this big shock. What's going on? This something bad must have happened. And sure enough, it was just I needed gas. And sometimes over the simplest things, I'll do one of those, oh my gosh, you know, just because it just dawned on me. It just hit me. I forgot something. And yet nothing surprises the Lord. The Lord's still on the throne. The Lord's still in charge. He's still going to make beauty out of ashes, the oil of joy out of mourning. He's still got a plan in all of it. And we just kind of need to run to that plan like Peter and John did and kind of behold it and kind of take it in and believe it. And you know, there's just a lot of shocking news in this world. You know, my landlady who owns the house that we live in shared with me yesterday that her husband had died from complications from the coronavirus. And that was very bad news. And that would be like hearing about the news about Jesus. It's like, this is bad news as far as people understood. I mean, this guy did miracles. He was the Messiah. He was awesome. He knew the Word of God so perfectly. He was the Word of God. And now you just saw him die. But then to hear that he's alive, okay, the death could be a shock, but then the life is also a great shock. And so there are events that happen that are upsetting to life, and they upset everyone. In this particular case, the disciples, the Jewish community, and even the world. Sometimes we hear that word upset, and we think of somebody being mad, but sometimes they do that even in an election, when something was a surprise, and the person won who you didn't think would win, and there was an upset in that political election because people weren't expecting something. And so there are events that are game changers in this world. And the resurrection of Jesus Christ was one of those. Because now, no matter who the Jewish people would think the Messiah is from this time on, like, oh, maybe it's this rabbi, maybe it's that rabbi. The whole world who would hear about Jesus Christ would, no, it's this guy from Nazareth that's the Messiah. And so for all of history, it would be a world upset as to who, you know, the Messiah would be. And also in Acts chapter 4, verse 12, it says, "For there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved." See, people would think like, well, it's the law that we've got to follow God, and this is the way man is going to be saved. And yet it would be the Messiah, and it would be a name, and it would be the name of Jesus, and there'd be no other name that mankind could be saved by. So his death was a terrible shock, something that the mind couldn't grab a hold of if you loved him and you were following him, and you had all these questions as to why God would let something like this happen. And you know, God has answers for those questions, those why questions. And you wonder, well, did I miss out on something? Is there something I didn't hear? And then the resurrection, because the Jews were saying, well, make sure the tomb is secured unless his disciples steal the body at night and then they say that he resurrected, because they were paying attention. They heard it. They were, you know, weighing on all of these words. And yet now, because the tomb was sealed by the governor, because it was watched by guards, they're thrown into confusion. Now they have to come up with some other idea of what should be said now that Jesus is not there. And I'll tell you what, that's the way the world is. They just have to grapple with the whole thing. They've got to figure out, okay, what does the death mean? What does it mean to me? What does the resurrection mean? What does it mean for the world? And so the death and resurrection of Christ does cause us to contemplate. It disquiets the soul of man. It's an upset. And so either you're going to choose to be indifferent and unresponsive and just apathetic toward the plan of God, or you're going to rejoice that Jesus Christ is alive from the dead and your heart is going to be glad. Meaning there is something, some reaction, some response in the heart of man when we find out what happened. The Jewish leaders had an outrage at this revealing of this happening. But there's such an impact just on one man's sin. There's an impact on the whole world falling into sin. And then there's an impact on one man's resurrection, leading many who were dead in their trespasses and sins to be made alive in Christ. So the Lord's got a major plan. And the Lord didn't just upset that time, but the entire time continuum. It's almost like the clock stopped for a moment and the sun stood still. And there was an upset in the balance of the natural order because the dead don't rise. And this being the one who was the resurrection and the life and does even raise the dead, and he himself was raised from the dead. It didn't fit the models and the graphs that man would have of how the world is supposed to operate. And so in this time, we have the disturbance of the coronavirus, and it's causing casualties, it's causing instability, and it took the world by surprise. And you know, that's a big deal, and it's hard. But I will tell you that the death and resurrection is still bigger and still is the greatest shock and surprise to mankind that a person who's on their dying bed needs to hear, a person who's in a line trying to find a new job is trying to hear. And so all of us, we need to know that this is the greatest thing. And this is what I'm touching upon today. This is what every church is touching upon today, that this message gives people a jolt. It either bounces them back and away from Christ, and it becomes a stench in their nostrils, or whatever that mighty power was that they touched upon. They're like, what is that power? I got to know. You know, I have a story one time, and those of you that are young people will be interested in this, that are sitting with your families or watching alone right now, especially some of you young adults. But I was a young adult at the time, 20 years old, and I was working at a Christian high school. And I was doing three things. I was leading a study hall class, I was running the lunchroom, and I was a janitor. I mean, we're talking about a janitor for the whole school. And so I was doing all of that. But when the one time when I was in the study hall class, which was like sixth period, and the kids are all supposed to be doing their work, and I'm just sitting at a desk, supposed to be, you know, just answering any questions I could, but just watching them. But these couple of boys were asking me questions about the Lord, even though it was a Christian high school. And so we're in this long conversation. And these were somewhat mischievous boys because, I mean, they had twisted staples one day and put them on my seat. And I'm like, hey, what are you guys doing? And so this is a true story. It's only happened one time in my life. I can't explain it, but I promise you that it really happened. So as I was talking to them, and I'm seated here, and I'm seated like in front of the desk, and they're seated in chairs in front of the desk. And I was talking to them about the Lord, and they were intently getting into what I was saying. And I was talking, I put out my hands like that in just the conversation, what I was saying, just hand motions. And when I put out my hands like that, their chairs went back. Like, I mean, literally, like, moved back like that, and their bodies flew back. And it was and they're going, what was that? And I go, I don't know. And they freaked out. And it was just... maybe there was, you know, some energy in the air of electricity, and just my hands just hit the electricity just right, and boom, their chairs jolted. I mean, we all saw it. It really happened. But what it was I think it was a sign for them. They needed to be jolted out of their thinking and where they were at. I mean, and they were asking me questions, you know, like where the Bible says, you know, pray without ceasing. I mean, you know, who could never stop praying? You got to sleep. And then if I take a math test, you mean I'm supposed to pray the whole time I'm doing the math test? Well, some people should be praying the whole time they're doing their math test. But, you know, they're trying to be reasonable and out-reason God. And God's going, you know what? You can't out-reason me. And definitely, I will tell you, definitely that affected those young guys. But, you know, Jesus, he experienced this great emotional stress in that garden where he sweat drops of blood. It says he was crying with vehement tears to him that was able to save him. He ends up with the crown of thorns on him and the whip to his back. And all of that was worth it to him for the shock waves that he would bring to the world, that there would be joy to the world. There would be salvation offered to the world through his blood and through his death. And there would be new news, not the old news of his death, but new news of his life, that he is alive from the dead. So everything we go through has a plan, just as Jesus' life and death had a plan. And so the fiery trials that we go through promise a glory that will follow. It says in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 17, 2 Corinthians 4, 17, for our light affliction, which is but for a moment, like the things we go through right now are very temporary. What we're going through with the coronavirus, even in Los Angeles, I mean, we got to hunker down in our homes until the middle of May. That's the new rule. But you know what? We're going to all be okay. You that have anxieties, we're going to be okay. I can promise you that. I understand where the scriptures say these kinds of things are leading. And so it's working for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. The temporary things are working for us something that's bigger, something that's bolder, not only in our lives now, but in the life that is to come. And we can praise the Lord for that. And those fiery trials are a surprise. They do take us by surprise, but the Bible also tells us that we shouldn't be surprised at the fiery trials which are going to try us. Now, there's a scripture in Mark chapter 16 that talks about the resurrection. In Mark chapter 16, verse 6, it says, but he said to them, do not be alarmed. Like, don't be surprised. Don't be shocked. You seek Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He is risen, with an exclamation point. He is not here. See the place where they've laid him. And this is the angels talking to the ladies. Do not be alarmed. Don't be so shocked. Don't be so surprised. He's risen. He's alive. So if you're in a mode and a startled place in your life, and life is coming at you, whether it be with deaths or with fears and viruses, take heart. Have peace of mind. Don't remain in the upset state and the distressed state. In John chapter 13, verse 19, it says this, John 13, 19. Those of you that are reading your Bible, pop it open, look there. John 13, 19, it says, now I tell you before it comes, that when it does come to pass, you may believe that I am he. I'm letting you know ahead of time, it's going to come to pass. And when all these things happen, you're going to know that he is God. He is Lord. He is King of Kings. And so God uses massively abnormal things in ways that are higher than our ways. He uses things that just don't fit in to our understanding, you know, in crossing our T's and dotting our I's and putting everything, all our ducks in a row. To the finite mind, sometimes all of these things swirl around and they're confined in our thinking. And God, you know, like you talk in a workplace or in a school, to think outside of the box with life and with your experiences and your trials and even these present trials. God is saying, just don't let it be confined to here. Pour out your heart before him. Give it all over to God, because God has a plan. And so the Spirit of God who lives inside of a believer, and if you ask Jesus Christ into your heart, you know, the Spirit of God will come and live inside of you. And the Spirit is a shock absorber, like in a car. You know, if it went over bumps and it had no shock absorbers, it'd just be boom, boom, you know. But a shock absorber causes it to take away a lot of that shock. And so the Holy Spirit also, peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you, not as the world gives do I give unto you. I give you peace that passes all understanding. It's a shock absorber. And so God helps us to get over the bumps in the road, including this one. He causes us to bounce back. He causes us to understand what he's doing. I said I was going to die. I said I was going to resurrect. I said in the world you will have tribulation. Be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. Guess what? These present circumstances, you too will overcome. And so you go from a state of injury like Jesus' injuries and a state of death, and sometimes everything feels like it's dying, to something that is more than a man can do. To a state of resurrection, to the state of the angels saying he is alive, to the state of Jesus appearing to his disciples and showing himself with proof as he eats fish and some bread with them, saying, you know, that he's not a ghost. Flesh and bones, you know, isn't going to sit here and eat bread with you. I mean, well, flesh and bones, yes, but a ghost isn't. And so in Isaiah chapter 52, verse 14, Isaiah chapter 52, verse 14, it says, just as many were astonished at you, so his visage was marred more than any man, and his form more than the sons of man. Jesus experienced a horrific death beyond what other people had experienced, where it was unrecognizable that he was even a man in the sense, of course, of his body, that it was bloodied and tortured as it had been. And so it was even outside of the norm of deaths in the type of death that he died. Not that other people weren't crucified, but the beating he took was so much more. And it was God using this to shake up a world that just wanted everything to be normal, religion the same as normal. And so God uses our lives to shake us up, to wake us up. And so they put a blindfold on Jesus, and they beat him, and they spit upon him. Well, you know, you and I, we have masks now to cover our nose, to cover our mouths. And I've heard that even past May 15th, it's going to be a rule in Los Angeles to have to wear those when you're out and about. And yet the Lord uses all of those things that seem to be, you know, way out there and things that we never wanted, we never expected. And God uses those to teach our hands for war, to train us for what's next. Jesus raising from the dead was, according to his own words, the sign of the prophet Jonah, as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the whale. So the Son of Man is going to be in the heart of the earth as he preached to the spirits that were in prison on the side that was called Hades, and then also the side that was called paradise, and he took them up and resurrected them when he resurrected. And then, of course, they all went to heaven. And that was an early resurrection there. But you and I, God wants us to just understand that our Savior, who at one time was unrecognizable in his visage as a man, is now seated at the right hand of the Father and is resurrected and in his glorified body. And so maybe you don't have instantaneous gladness over this. I know sometimes there's maybe a spouse that's listening right now that you're hearing it and you're going, well, this is great, Pastor John. Well, you know, you're teaching this and you believe in this. But, you know, my thoughts are going this way and that way, and there's things that are a little too perplexing for me, or parts of it offend me. And how could he be the cornerstone that fits everything together? Well, I will tell you that Jesus not only was the message that turned the world upside down back then, but Jesus is the one who will turn the world upside down today. That he was the first fruits of those who raised from the dead, and he will bring many sons to glory. According to 1 Corinthians chapter 15, I'm going to read this to you, verse 21. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 21. It says, "For since by man came death, by man also came the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ all shall be made alive. But in each one in his own order, Christ the first fruits, and after those who are Christ at his coming." So Jesus was dead. And I want you to hear those words. He was dead and was a past tense. But now he is alive. Something that's an impossibility, a non-reality, becomes the reality that God has for mankind to shock us with, to surprise us with, but something that we need to know. "For my son was dead and is alive again. And that was dead. And they began to be merry," in this particular story, in Luke chapter 15, verse 24. That's the story of the prodigal son. And then in Revelation chapter 1, verse 18, it says, "I am he who lives and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen." This is our Jesus, alive forevermore. Revelation 2, 8, "who was dead and came to life." This is he who was dead and came to life. And I want to close on a particular passage to help you come to Christ, some of you that need to know Jesus Christ as your Lord and your Savior. It says in John chapter 5, verse 24, "Most assuredly I say to you, all of you who are listening, he who hears my word, he who hears the word of Jesus and believes in him who sent me has everlasting life." It says, "and shall not come into judgment, but has passed from death to life." And that's what I want to say to you. God wants to take you from the darkness of your life and the unforgiven and unrepentant sin and bring you to God, from death to life. Your own personal resurrection today. Verse 25 says, "Most assuredly, I say to you, the hour is coming, and now is, when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live." Those who hear our landlord, Alan, and hopefully he knew the Lord. I know that he was going to church and visiting Christian churches, and so he may have known the Lord, and all who knew the Lord. It says, will live. I mean, God knows the heart, right? And we don't always hear, we don't know people well enough to always hear their confession of faith. But it says, most assuredly I say to you, the hour is coming now, that when the dead are going to hear his voice, the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live. And God wants to raise from the dead. He wants to raise up hearts. He wants to raise up lives that are going to serve him, and they're going to be with him, not only in glory, but when he's coming back on that white horse. And then it says, for as the Father has life in himself, he's granted the Son to have life in himself, so that Jesus has that life to give to us. Verse 27 of John 5 says, and he's given him authority to execute judgment also, because he is the Son of Man. Do not marvel at this, for the hour is coming in which all who are in the graves will hear his voice and come forth. Those who have done good to the resurrection of life. So those who have done good, okay? I mean, what's the best thing you could do? Is believe, right? And then, of course, the good works that you do as a result of believing. And what do you believe in? You believe in Jesus. So it says those who have done good, they come up to the resurrection of life. And those who have done evil, they've not repented, they've rejected the Lord. It says to the resurrection of condemnation. Isn't that interesting that the Bible talks about two resurrections? Which resurrection do you want to be a part of? The resurrection of life or the resurrection of condemnation? His resurrection was a miraculous, glorious resurrection. And yet the other resurrection is for those that are not willing to come to him. But if you come to him, he will not cast you out. So I'd like to lead you in a prayer. If there's any child or teenager, mom or dad, grandpa or grandma, or anybody, or maybe you tune this in later and you'd like to receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, I want to pray with you right now. And just pray this prayer with me. Just say, dear Jesus, I believe you died on the cross. Dear Jesus, I believe you rose from the dead. And dear Jesus, I know that you are coming back again. And just say, I ask you to forgive me of all my sins. I ask you to come into my heart. I believe you died on the cross. I believe you rose again from the dead. And I want to follow you, Jesus, for the rest of my life. And if you prayed that prayer and you believed that prayer and you believed in Jesus Christ, you will be born again. And because Jesus lives, you will live also. God bless you guys. Have a great day today. This will play again at 5:00. It's premiering. Obviously, everybody can talk to each other while it's live. But share it with your family. I'm sure you know somebody who isn't listening to an online service who you want to bring the salvation of Jesus Christ to them. And so this is your day to just share it. Go on and share it. If you want to go to Friday's message, it was about the cross. And I did part one on Wednesday, part two on Friday, if you missed that. All right. At the end now, we're going to have worship. We've got other things, and we've got a special message at the end, too, of a lot of people from our church. They're going to come on and share, so you don't want to miss that. Because I've noticed on all of the online messages that whether we had worship at the beginning or whether we had it at the end, that the numbers of people watching are dropping when worship is on, and then they come back when the teaching is on. We want you to stick around for the worship, okay? And then stick around for your church family coming on and sharing a bunch of really short messages with you. All right, you guys. God bless you.
Always a great time when you get to worship with the family, right? Well, right now we're going to be switching over to our special guest worship. And if you've been here on Wednesday nights, you have seen her perform for us and lead us in worship. She and I have known each other for about a year now. And she's just been in and out of our church and just everywhere that she's been. I know that she's guest worship at other different churches, and she leads worship at Calvary Chapel Hollywood. And she's just a great sister in the Lord, and worships with all her heart. She's got a great voice. You're going to love her. I hope that she just inspires you and leads you into even more special time of worship right now. So please welcome Jack Marino.
Thank you. Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. Darkness veils his lovely face. I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand.
So we're going to give our tithes and offerings right now. What better way to give back to the Lord and say thank you for all he's done for us than to give up of ourselves to him? If you don't know, there's a couple different ways to give. There's the typing it on the internet, ccwhittier.org. You can give that way. There's also through text or through downloading the application, the First Love application. You can give through that way, or I believe there's also Venmo and Zelle. So you can give through any of the various means, whatever the Lord puts on your heart. Just let it be a gift from yourself unto him and let him use it the way he wants to use it. So let's go ahead and ask him to bless our tithes and offerings and just say how thankful we are for him. Lord, we just praise you for being our good God, our glorious Savior. There's so much that you have given us, Lord. We just pray that for what we can give back to you, Lord, that you just bless and that you multiply. We don't know where you have the need, Lord, but we trust that of giving ourselves, the needs will be fulfilled, Lord. So, Lord, we just pray that you bless, you multiply, and we just see miracles being done through this, Lord. Lord, we love you, we thank you, and we praise you. In your name I pray. Amen.
Yeah. Good morning, First Love family. Me and my wife just wants to wish you guys a happy Easter. Continue to keep the church and our pastors in prayer. God bless. See you guys soon.
Hi, everybody. Hi. From our home to your home, we just want to say hi. Happy Easter. We miss you.
I just want to say, let our focus be on the cross and what he has done for us. God is good.
And I just want to say a Christmas light, Calvary, and another yellow.
Again, we'll see you real soon. Happy Resurrection Day.
Hi, family. Wishing you all a happy Resurrection Day. We sure miss all you guys. We pray that you guys would be blessed and you would experience the power of Christ this Easter celebration.
So blessed to be able to have this technology to say happy Easter. Love you guys. See you all soon.
Hi, everybody. Rich and Melissa Christensen here. We just wanted to wish you guys a happy Resurrection Day. And we miss you guys and we love everybody at church. And we'll see you all soon.
Hi, guys. Just want to say hello to everybody. We miss you guys. We miss your families, your kids. We can't wait to hang out soon and worship together. God bless.
Happy Resurrection Day.
He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
We miss you guys.
Yes, we
have
do.
A great day. God bless.
God bless.
Hi, happy Easter. From Maureen Schaefer, I'm the Director of Women's Ministries, and I'm John Schaefer's wife. And I'm just excited that we have a Savior who is willing to die for sins he didn't commit and took the place that I deserved. And I'm so thankful that when they went to the tomb, it was empty. That one of the best things we've ever found is when we didn't find what we were looking for. Isn't that true? So I know I serve a risen Savior. And because he lives, I live. Happy Easter to you all. Have a great Resurrection Day.